Hey guys, what's up? So I finally managed to tune up my Ryzen 9950X, and in this video, I'll guide you through the entire process of improving performance by up to 10% in multi-core while staying stable. I also share some additional tweaks that you can apply, so buckle up because it's going to be a bit long one. For this video, I'll be using my trusty MSI X670EA's motherboard, but most of the important tweaks can be applied pretty much the same on other MSI boards or from a different brand. I previously used the same board with the Ryzen 7950X and later on the 7950X3D, and it's updated to the latest BIOS as of this date, so it has fully Ryzen 9000 series support. The cooler I'm using is an AIO also by MSI, the MVG Core Liquid S360. I've had it for almost 2 years now. While it's not the latest gen of liquid coolers, but still getting the job done. Alright, so now I put it to the BIOS dashboard. By default, it's set to basic mode, so I'll go ahead and press F7 to switch over to the advanced mode. Before exploring the OC tab, let's head to settings, then advanced, AMD overclocking, and SOC / Uncore OC mode. I have it enabled, and what it does is setting CPU Uncore components such as the Infinity Fabric, memory, and iGPU to run at their maximum speed. Essentially, when you enable RAM OC, including XMP or Expo profiles, it activates this option. Let's go back and go to DDR and Infinity Fabric, frequency / timings, then DDR options. A few BIOS versions ago, MSI added this DDR5 Nitro mode, which as said here, it improves support when you have memory speed set over 6000 MTS. So in case you have your RAM running at over 6000 MTS, make sure to enable that. Once you do, you can set various features like DDR5 robust training mode that improves memory stability at higher speed but increases memory training time. There are also various options related to timings between the memory controller and PHY, but enabling any of them may increase memory latency in return. So in summary, DDR5 Nitro mode is mainly for when you have memory running at over 6000 MTS. And given that mine are running at just about 6000 MTS, not above that, I can simply keep it off to minimize any unneeded training time increase. Now let's move on to controller configurations, then DDR power options, and disable here power down enabled. By default, it's set to auto, and I believe it's disabled. But just to make sure, when you enable that, what it does is booting memory in power saving mode when the PC isn't in use, but it may contribute to some blue screen of death and stability issues. Also performance downgrade, which is why most people usually turn it off. Now let's go all the way back from settings and get to the OC part. The first important thing is making sure our OC Explore mode is set to expert in order to unlock all available options. We'll now head on to advanced CPU configuration. Here by using the compact TDP, you can choose to limit the TDP based on your cooling or case factor to minimize heat and power consumption. There are different options to choose from, but I'll keep mine on auto since we are prioritizing performance in here. Then let's go to AMD overclocking, then precision boost overdrive. Next, set precision boost overdrive mode to advanced. In my motherboard, MSI has made some special pre-made boosting modes like the enhanced mode boost 1 and mode 2, and others as well that use certain thermal points. But I usually go with advanced and set them manually just like the following. PBO limits to motherboard. This will ensure we are using the BBT, TDC, and EDC limits set by the motherboard manufacturer, so it doesn't exceed what it's capable of. Decision boost overdrive is scaled to 10x to keep high and sustain the clocks under heavy load. CPU boost clock override to positive 200 MHz, which is the maximum. It may not necessarily get that 200 MHz boost, but I've noticed that in single core workloads, it will push the clocks a bit higher with this one activated. And I'll keep the GPU clock override and thermal throttle limit to auto. In the GFX curve optimizer, you can use the curve optimizer for the iGPU to squeeze a bit of performance out of it if you use the iGPU for gaming. Next, we have the traditional CPU curve optimizer that's been used since the Ryzen 5000 series. What the curve optimizer does is shifting the voltage it takes to reach a specific frequency. So if you push it in a negative direction, it shifts the curve magnitude down and thus giving us clocks for lower voltage and even reaching higher ones thanks to having new high point. While with positive values, we increase the voltage peak frequency, so usually this isn't advisable to use. In the previous generations, we considered per core, which was quite hard because in many core CPUs, you would trip off only because one core had wrong value. Or all cores, which was quite similar and easier to tune up, and I used it personally. But in this new gen, we can also specify it per CCD. So we can specify it for CCD1 and CCD2. The maximum point we can apply is 30, either for positive or negative values. But forget all of that, because the 9000 series introduced yet a new way to maximize performance by now shaping the curve rather than optimizing it. The curve shaper is actually better because it allows you to set aggressive shifting points at lower frequencies. So we have minimum, low, medium, high, and max frequency points. With this generation, I use the curve shaper instead of the curve optimizer. And much like the curve optimizer, we can shift the curve either in positive or negative points. The maximum value is also here, 30. Additionally, here you can also adjust the curve based on temperatures. So besides frequency speed, you can choose for when it has low, medium, or high temperature. For me personally, after testing for days, I found the following settings to be super stable, at least on my unit. Set all of minimum, low, and medium to negative 30 across all temp levels. On high to negative 20 and max to negative 12. This way, we shift the curve to be very aggressive at low clocks, improving performance in low power states while increasing performance beyond all at max clock speed. However, we can't go much more aggressive as it will compromise stability at higher clocks. That stability behavior I encountered if I went too aggressive with them was occasional system freezing, not blue screen of death or reboot. So it's even more annoying and it's tricky because it may not have been during stability test or benchmarks, but during normal use like simply opening a PDF or browsing the internet. That's why after trial and error, I settled to negative 20 on high and I tested negative 12 to negative 13 on max and it's stable on both. So you can choose negative 12 or negative 13 and I think it will be stable. Of course, silicon quality and motherboard VRM quality play a role in here, but I think generally speaking, this point could be optimal for most of us. Let's go back and go to AMD CBS. Here what I usually do is disabling the global C state to avoid the PC going into very lower power states, because since we use the curve shaper, shift clocks to use less voltage, mostly minimum, low, and mid states, it may cause random reboots if the PC enters very low power states. Also because, as we all know, disabling global C state has proven to improve game stuttering issues in some scenarios. So I usually turn it off and also disable the secure virtual machine or SVM because disabling it may give a small performance improvement. And also because I don't use system virtualization. It's an optional change, so you can keep it on if you need it, but I usually keep it off. Let's head all the way back to the main OC menu. Here we have a new RAM option by MSI called Optimized Performance Profile, where you can select an overclocking profile for your RAM kit. And when you enable it, it deactivates the Expo option. Since my G-Scale RAM fully supports Expo, I'll go with Expo option. But my favorite MSI feature is the High Efficiency Mode. By enabling that one, it unlocks memory timing presets for the memory. We can then choose between Relax, Balance, Tighter, and Tightest. Those options reduce memory timings to improve memory performance. Now, stability may vary based on your RAM tolerance, but surprisingly on my 790 50X and 790 50X 3D, I could only set it maximum to the tighter option. At tightest one, it wouldn't boot. So I used always the tighter option instead. However, with the 9950X, it manages to boot and work all fine on the tightest option. So that made me believe that the new Ryzen has better memory compatibility to some extent. It's exactly the same memory that's compatible across both generations. Here you can see the difference in timings it's set in different presets. So in theory, having it on tightest should give us an edge in RAM performance. Now I'm thinking to do a future comparison of performance between these modes, as I did before, to opt the tighter option back in the last generation. So be sure to subscribe to be updated on that. For the remaining of this video, I'll keep it on the tight list. Additionally, there's also memory triad, where you can try your luck choosing speeds and memory timings that may not be compatible with your RAM, but could work anyway. We also have memory context restore, which minimizes booting time in some situations by avoiding memory training at warm boots like restarting, etc. While it may be good, but be warned that you may get random blue screen of this with it on, and I personally usually do, which is why I keep it disabled. Now getting to voltages, with the PBO setup approach, it's best to keep CPU core voltage on auto. I also set the CPU soak voltage to 1.2 volt, just like I did with the previous generation, and it's pretty stable with it. While socket burning was addressed long time ago, but I got this habit now to set it to manual 1.2 volt. And it's been good with the last generation as well as this one. But of course, it may depend on your RAM speed as well. Now I want to show you by going to memory Z, we can see the installed RAM I have, which are 16x4, a total of 64 gigabytes of capacity. So I have all slots occupied, running Expo and all. Finally, I usually go to hardware monitor. Here you can turn up your fans or CPU cooler. Now what I do is turning on the smart mode and set them on PWM mode. Once you are done and settled to zero settings, you can save the profile in here. Finally, to apply them, go in settings, save and exit, then save changes and reboot. Okay, now that we have booted in and all, the first crucial step is stability testing. Usually my first go to stability test is ITA64 Extreme. It stresses not only the CPU, but FPU, cache, and memory all at the same time, and the frequency fluctuates quite a lot throughout the test, so it should be quite fast at spotting initial errors. So I ran it for 1 hour. And as you can see, we got no issues. Also, our temps are hovering at around 84 degrees. Next, I will test it on OCCT. The difference is that OCCT can be heavier and more demanding. But when you want to test it, make sure to use the CPU test and not the new one, CPU plus memory test, that stresses both the CPU and memory at the same time. So it may lift some stress off the CPU when you want to use the memory as well. For our purpose, we are focusing on CPU stability, so it's better to choose a CPU dedicated one. I'll set it to 30 minutes, which should be pretty enough. Mode will be to extreme, which uses more power and less memory, so the CPU relies on itself much more this way. I also set load type to variable, which varies operations regularly. Finally, for instruction set, I'll test it first on SSE and then AVX512. Now let's get to it. As you can see, it passed the SSE workload test flawlessly with no issues whatsoever. Now let's head on to the AVX512. And we got no problems at all, so it passed OCCT stability test with the flying colors. Let's check the Gazelle matrix throughout the OCCT test. For voltage, our max is 1.395 volt, which is within specs, and the tape of 95 degrees is normal for latest Ryzen CPUs because they now push themselves automatically to 95 degrees with PBO on. So it's completely designed this way. You get the maximum performance out of it based on your cooling and motherboard power capacity, and our maximum power consumption is 252 watts. Now we can move on to benchmarking in Cinebench R23 and then after in Cinebench 2024. I'll test both multi-core and single-core. And the score we got is 45,000 for multi-core and 2,252 for single-core. But that was while I was recording in OBS. If I run the test without recording, we even get about 45,200 for multi-core and 2,277 for single-core. While on default, we had 41,232 for multi-core and 2,248 for single-core. So about a 10% improvement in multi-core test. Then when we had only PBO without curve shaper, we have 43,367 for multi-core and 2,251 for single core. So about 2,003 points more with the curve shaper configuration. Now let's get to Cinebench 2024, also by doing the multi-core and single core tests. So our final score here is 2,503 for multi-core and 141 for single core. For default, we have 2,375 for multi-core and 140 for single one. So 125 points more from default to PBO plus curve shaper, and 60 points more from when we had only PBO turned on, while our single core test has only a 1 point improvement. And you can also see that on certain occasions, some cores hit the 5,855 MHz clock speed, and our max voltage is again 1.395 volt. So that's a defined max within what's normal. Also, temps are 95 degrees, which is totally fine. And power consumption is 254 watt. Now I want to show you, if I open the Ryzen Master and run the Cinebench multi-core test, when I have the default settings, you can see our clocks are around 4.8 GHz on CCD1 and 4.6 GHz and half on the second CCD. However, our temps are 80 degrees and power consumption is at around 160 watt. While with PBO without curve shaper, we got 95 degrees temp, about 215 watt, and it clocks over 5 GHz on CCD1 and 4.9 GHz on the second CCD. So roughly 200 MHz above the default on all cores. And if we combine the PBO plus the curve shaper, we still have 95 degrees temp, the same power consumption as PBO config, but our clocks are 5.2 GHz on all CCD1 cores and about the same on the second CCD. So you can see the gains we got thanks to the curve shaper. Finally, just for fun, I wanted to do a small gaming benchmark in Wukong, but running it in 4K would not be the best way to tell. However, I went with DLSS on ultra performance on an RTX 4090 with all settings maxed out to see what we can get in such scenario. You can immediately see that with default settings, we have the lowest power consumption, lowest temps, and about the same performance. You might see a small bump in FPS with PBO config, like maybe in 1080p or 1440p, a maximum of 5% or around that. But in 4K, gains could be pretty narrow. With only PBO activated, we got higher power consumption. But again, with PBO plus curve shaper, we got also the highest temps than all, probably due to the higher CPU utilization and clock ratios. Now definitely PBO with curve shaper should perform the best, but in 4K with max settings and ray tracing, it may not show up a lot. So anyways, that's about it for tuning the Ryzen 9950X. I will do more future videos about it, depending on the new fixes, performance improvement, BIOS features, and Windows performance optimization updates, as well as dedicated videos for the upcoming motherboards like the X870E. For now, I haven't settled on the brand to go with this time, so let me know which one you would like to see coverage for the upcoming chipset. Also remember, I try my best to do a specific one comparing the performance of the memory timing preset feature we have seen before, so be sure to subscribe to see it next. Also, I ask of you, if you think this video guide was useful, please give it a like to help with the YouTube algorithm. And if you have any questions or are facing any problems tuning your CPU, don't hesitate to write in the comments below and get in touch on the TechoSword Discord server. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one.